So, based on the popularity of my most recent video,
and on the frequency of questions about, hey, how does that thing work? What makes that thing open and close? I thought I would try to explain a little bit about the variable jet nozzle affixed to the afterburner. And we're going to read from the book produced by the people who designed it and manufactured it, so they might know a thing or two about it. That's a J79 variable exhaust nozzle. That's the short pedal one that makes all the noise, the screaming. We don't test them very often. Usually we have the long pedal nozzles, and they don't have the howling.
I was searching through some old boxes of manuals, and I found this little gem. It's an engine assembly shop practices handbook by the people who make the engine that was featured in my most recent video. So they're the people that make it, they're the people that designed it. It's 1972, so that was when that engine was almost 20 years old. Anyway, it's a fantastic little gem, because back in the day, they used to actually explain things. So, let's go to the first page I put here. We're gonna read through it, and we're gonna learn from it, you and me together. So, the exhaust jet nozzle. The jet nozzle is a converging, diverging, ejector, aerodynamic, variable area, supersonic jet nozzle. Whoa, there's a term. With primary and secondary nozzle flaps to control main and secondary airflow. Now, a lot of you people have asked me exactly how that thing works. We're going to find out today. It's a lot more complicated than it really is, than it really sounds like when I say it's pretty complicated. It's more complicated than that. The converging section is formed by the primary flaps, in which the air is accelerated at sonic velocity by a restricting squirting action. So the primary flaps are the inner ones in that video. They're the inner ones.
Well, the test cell's empty, but out here in the boneyard, we found ourselves a J79 with a variable nozzle. Let's have a bit of a look at it. First of all, these rods, there's four of them. They control the position of the primary flaps, and by association also the secondary flaps. They're hydraulic, and they're synchronized by a flexible drive cable that goes between all four of them, coordinating their position as they produce great force with these hydraulic rams underneath heat shields to close or open the nozzle. Okay, so this one is in the open position for obviously idling and shutdown. It's not running right now. I don't think I have to tell you that. But you can see the secondary flaps are here, the big ones. This engine has the longer secondary flaps, so it's not a screamer or a howler or a screecher. But anyway, here's the primary flaps are right here. Kind of flappy things.
The aerodynamic action is formed by the secondary airflow, in which the exhaust throat and the diverging surface are formed by the secondary airflow instead of the metal wall. So the orifice of the supersonic nozzle, the diverging surface, and the exhaust throat. So the minimum area of the exhaust convergent nozzle and the part where the air is supersonic, that is caused by air.
These don't really open up all the way. They still remain slightly convergent. And then, as the book explains to us, as the book written by the people who make this thing, the divergent section of the nozzle happens about here, and it's made of air. Very strange. Very strange. And then I guess quickly that air shape, the supersonic transition, opens up, and I'm only assuming that divergent nozzle is continued by the shape of these turkey feathers, petals, sections.
These are the secondary flaps here. Those are the primary. You can recognize them if you look at the video. So the convergent nozzle is actually formed by air. It's invisible. It's magic. I love that. The ejected secondary airflow will be accelerated to a higher velocity and will therefore contribute to the jet thrust.
there's that secondary airflow pathway that's easily seen here.
The diverging section is the supersonic nozzle section, so the diverging section. And the diverging section takes place, well, in afterburning, these secondary flaps are actually opened. So, it is formed by the secondary airflow and by the secondary nozzle flaps. The diverging action accelerates the main airflow to supersonic velocities by controlling the expansion of the gas so that the expansion, which is only partially completed in the convergent section, will be rearward and not outward. It'll be rearward and not outward to the side and be wasted. I added the B there, to the side and wasted. We're talking about the actual mechanics of the and the aerodynamics of the jet nozzle, and the hydromechanical computer that makes it do what it does is beyond the scope of this discussion. Yeah. Okay. Therefore, the exhaust nozzle is controlled to set low operating temperature at low power settings and is controlled to maintain a high continuous max operating temperature during military or AB power settings. So now we've got some illustrations of convergent, divergent nozzle, I guess, generic principles. Here's a converging nozzle with a high power setting because the gas leaving the accelerating nozzle is at supersonic velocity and it is still under pressure. So it expands to the side and to the rear. Some of what contributes to the thrust and a lot of it is wasted. So here we have a converging and a diverging nozzle. So now the pressure lowers as it expands. And I want to take this opportunity at this moment to explain that supersonic airflow is exactly the opposite of subsonic airflow. All of you people, actually somebody yesterday explained one of my videos saying the diffuser, as it opens up, causes expansion and therefore lowering of pressure, which is exactly incorrect. That would happen at supersonic velocities, but it happens at subsonic velocities, so it's all backwards. Don't ask me why it's backwards. That's the magic of Mother Nature and physics and the universe as we know it. Subsonic aerodynamics. As the air goes through a diverging pathway, it seems to expand, but it increases the pressure. It increases the pressure, not decreases the pressure. Yes, it does. Check with your physics teacher, any textbook. Check with NASA. Check with anybody. That's the way it is. Intuitively, it's wrong, but actually, physically, it's right. Converging throat. Subsonic reaches sonic velocity at this line. So even though it goes from converging to diverging, it's accelerating and lowering pressure here, and it's accelerating and lowering pressure there. Because at the sonic transition, the laws flip exactly 180 degrees. They're totally opposite. Controlled expansion. So there's more thrust going to the rear here than there is there. There's no wasted thrust. This is a sort of a pictorial examination or representation of the J79 nozzle. This is the open afterburning position. Here's what they call the primary flap, the secondary flap, and there's an air pathway right through there, which is the secondary air, they call it. Supersonic nozzle theory. The ideal supersonic exhaust nozzle is a converging, diverging shape in which the tailpipe pressure and temperature energy is converted into a high jet velocity, kinetic energy. The gas in the nozzle achieves its increase in velocity by the expansion of the gas from a high pressure to a large increased volume. A converging diverging nozzle shape controls the volume expansion so that the expansion is directed into the rearward into the jet velocity. In the converging section where the velocities are still low, subsonic, converging, subsonic, each individual gas molecule is being squeezed by the converging shape and pushed from behind. This three-dimensional squirting action causes the velocity to increase. Since this velocity increase is faster than the volume expansion, a converging area is necessary to maintain the squirting action. okay? In the converging section, the velocity cannot exceed the speed of sound because as the gas velocity increases, the ability of the gas pressure to move the molecules from behind becomes less. In fact, the pushing action will drop to zero when the gas moves at the speed of sound. The speed of sound is the speed of the natural pressure wave movement. It is dependent upon the natural internal molecular velocity, which is limited by the amount of internal temperature energy of these gas molecules. In other words, the speed of sound, although it is a pressure wave, is limited by the speed of the molecular velocity, or sound temperature energy. So hotter makes it go faster. In the diverging section, the gas velocities are increased above the speed of sound. The individual gas molecules cannot be pushed by the pressure or molecules behind them. Therefore, the gas molecules can be accelerated only by increasing the gas volume outward and rearward. The diverging section allows expansion outward, but also holds in the expansion so that most of the expansion is directed rearward off the side wall of the diverging section. If most of the supersonic expansion can be done within the diverging section, a good nozzle efficiency can be maintained. So the diverging section of a supersonic condyne nozzle is a lot like a rocket nozzle. Note that at the throat area, the gas velocity is equal to the speed of sound, which is dependent upon the amount of gas temperature, internal molecular velocity. Velocity sound equals square root of, looks like alpha GRTS. But basically, the speed of sound is higher in a hotter gas, so it can move faster. One of the things that helps the afterburner work. However, this is not a velocity limit. The gas can be expanded to supersonic velocities. All right, so I'm going to show you now. One of the books that I recommend is this one. See that? Oh, there we go. Bill Gunston, Jet and Turbine Aero Engines, the Development of. A lot of interesting stuff. We're going to go to the chapter on jet pipes. So we're going to start here. In a simple turbojet, the pipe terminates in a convergent nozzle. The nozzle area and degree of convergence depends on the upstream gas conditions and the design maximum speed of the aircraft. Normally, the nozzle is designed to accelerate the jet as nearly as possible back to atmospheric pressure. Which means that, as I state so vehemently in my video called Jet Engine Thrust? Maybe I just called it Thrust. Pressure times area is not how you figure the thrust of a jet engine. Pressure times nozzle exit area is a very tiny contributing factor to the overall thrust, and in an ideal engine that would be zero. In a simple convergent nozzle, the jet velocity in most operating conditions will be close to Mach 1, the speed of sound, which in the hot gas means about 2,000 feet per second, the muzzle velocity of a typical rifle bullet. At exactly Mach 1, a clear limit on jet expansion and acceleration is reached because a normal 90 degree shock wave will inevitably form across the nozzle, causing it to be choked. A shock wave basically acting like a cover on the nozzle, normal to the surface or at 90 degrees, causing it to be choked. And a choked nozzle means that the pressure can increase upstream, but doesn't make the gas come out any faster. It just leaves at a higher pressure. And that, a choked nozzle will increase thrust by the pressure times area, but very inefficiently because here's a choked nozzle. There's a choked nozzle right there. So you're getting a little bit of extra thrust by the pressurized gas leaving the nozzle, and then a lot of it wasted. On a convergent nozzle with increasing pressure, it doesn't leave any faster. It just leaves at a higher pressure, and then I guess almost like popcorn, it expands once it's out of the engine, and some of it will push the engine forward, a lot of it's wasted. So back to Bill's book, Bill Gunston. We have already seen with the passages between blades of a compressor or turbine that the flow through a choke duct cannot be increased by pressure alone. Any attempt to increase pressure upstream of a choke nozzle merely pushes the compressor towards the surge line because the turbine exhaust pressure is going up. Though the increased static pressure of the gas passing through the nozzle does add what is called pressure thrust equal to the air extra pressure multiplied by the nozzle area, as I just mentioned. This is an addition to the basic thrust due to the change in momentum of the flow through the engine. Pressure thrust is an inefficient answer. It is much better to continue trying to reduce the jet pressure to atmospheric and thus convert all the excess energy to velocity. And that is done by the convergent and then the divergent portion of the nozzle. The divergent portion is for the supersonic gases still accelerating, almost like popcorn expanding. Okay. I think we're going to hold there, because it's getting pretty wordy, it's getting pretty long. I want you guys to let me know if you like these types of instruction videos, or if they're boring as hell. I guess we tried to explain a little bit about the theory of a convergent, divergent, supersonic jet accelerating nozzle, and the practicalities of how it actually works according to the people who built it. So, if, like me, you're interested in these things and they seem very mysterious and almost magical, they are very complicated and the science involved is pretty much above my level and your level. We can try to pick away at it and get some of the basics. I don't want to do a whole lot of math. Those of you who do that kind of stuff, you're probably engineers. It's easy for you and that's great. We little people, we're just trying to understand what that nozzle's doing when it's expanding and contracting.
Look at that. Is that the carcass of a stainless steel space whale? A space dolphin? Those are the heat shields fitted around the engine. So this nozzle actually has some new sections installed. They were new, replaced before it was retired. And it's also, it must have been manipulated a bit when it was separate, because it's in a partially closed position. It's not fully open for idle. It's not fully closed for any kind of maximum thrust. It's in a transition between the two. And just for fun, here is the manufacturer's label. This is made by FN of Belgium, the guys that make the guns. Yes, and the engine was. It was licensed, built in Belgium. It's well, this isn't the engine data plate, but I think it's a dash 10 or a dash 11 J79. License built by FN of Belgium. So that's where the torch igniter would be. And yeah, it certainly looks like a brand new screech liner, combustor liner, whatever you want to call it. Looking out through the primary nozzle, just able to see a little bit of the secondary nozzle of an afterburner. Oh yeah, and let's back up a little bit and see this gap here. You see that gap? It's hard to see because it's in shadow. That's probably half an inch or whatever. That's where air goes exiting the engine. So it's turbine exhaust. It's hot, 800 degrees or so. But it acts as a cooling layer and it travels between the liner and the outer case to keep the outer case at a nice, happy 800 degrees Fahrenheit, maybe 900. As opposed to the 2500 or so that's going to be in the flame in the afterburner right through here when the afterburner's on. Another short segment nozzle, a screamer. And the Rolls-Royce Spey afterburner, it seems to have an outer encasing structure that is moved by the pistons. And it moves somewhat shorter segments. Okay, we haven't got the books on the Spey afterburner, but those look like a bit more substantially solid metal tiles right there that are the liner. And then there's these, looks like the primary nozzle. I don't know if there's a secondary nozzle, but this thing is also attached to the mechanical arrangement. And there's the There's the cooling air gap. You can see daylight through there. So maybe the, I'm sure the nozzle functions differently in a Spey than a J79. Maybe it doesn't have the aerodynamic choke point. Not sure. They're all different and they're all the same. Somebody hurt that a little bit. That would be very expensive to fix, and that's why we have this thing basically for parts, and it'll be unlikely to run ever again. A lot of our stuff's like that. See the cooling air holes up there, and then an escape path for cooling air right there. And these look very similar to the J79. They're about the same, the primary nozzle segments, about the same. Covered in soot, as usual. You get a lot of that with jet engines. And my apologies to Graham and all you other Brits out there. I shouldn't be calling this an afterburner section. I should be calling it a reheater. A reheater? A reheat section or a reheater? I can't find a data plate on it, but I did find this. If we go down here, way down here, way down there, we have a label that calls this a staging unit. The staging unit probably controls the fuel flow through these, maybe, to the different sections of reheat available through the fuel manifold to the Rolls-Royce afterburning Spey. Oh, reheating Spey. The reheat Spey. The Spey with reheat? Probably out of a Royal Navy Phantom. Just guessing. And for the true gearheads among us, here's some new and nearly new parts. That's a rear frame. And that's the ring that goes back and forth with the actuators, and it moves the primary and secondary flaps. Here is the jet pipe, which is basically stripped bare of all that machinery. And that is the long pedal nozzle segment. The long segment nozzle, sort of being held apart by a brace. This would bolt on to this thing and be moved by the ring. Oops. Danger of being caught in all this jungle of stainless steel here. There is a rear frame and another rear frame. And off in the corner, that is a two or a three, or two or a four. That's a four pipe fuel manifold for an afterburner. Let's see if I can figure out how to work this. Oh yeah. That's a four line manifold that hooks up to the afterburner spray bars. Pretty cool. And then there's a bunch of miscellaneous lines and stuff here. And that's the inner guts of a new variable nozzle. Missing a lot of pieces. Super cool. Isn't it beautiful? Let's see, look at that. Let's see, look at that thing. Amazing. Okay, whoops. That's a midframe. That's where the standard fuel nozzles go into. And this is the back end of it. This is leading into the 10 combustor liners. And in the center hole, in there, that's where the main thrust bearing goes. Right in there. I think this piece is new. Brand new. We're back out here in the boneyard. And there's a torch igniter. That thing there. That thing. I've shown them before in greater detail out of the engine in previous videos a long time ago. Inside there is a fuel nozzle and a source of ignition, a sparker. And at the very front of this, let's see if I can sneak around with the camera. I can't see what we're looking at. At the very front of that, there should be a hole, hopefully. And I can feel it, but I can't see it. And that allows some air to go in there. So air, fuel, and spark in this little thing. And it acts like a torch. We call it a torch igniter. And fire comes out here and is right here. This is a flame holder. It causes turbulence. And the fuel sprayed by these These have 20, 21 or 23, I think there's 23 of these, and there's 21 holes in each one that spray fuel. So there's a great mist of fuel coming out, and the flame holder causes turbulence, so there's a bunch of fuel and turbulence and air and fire. So that goes kawoom, and you have fire, and it stays here so the flame doesn't blow out. And because of what we were just talking about, the nozzles, the jet nozzle, that causes the acceleration from relatively high pressure, low velocity, to relatively high velocity, low pressure at the nozzle. So in the actual jet pipe, the flame doesn't really blow out because it's not moving that fast. The air in here is not moving as fast as you think it is. It's accelerated massively by this nozzle. So that flame holder doesn't cause a huge loss of efficiency because it's not in a supersonic wind. The supersonic wind happens here. I would guess the speed of the gases from that in the larger diameter of the jet pipe, somewhere around, I don't know, 250 to 400 miles per hour, so 400 to 600 kilometers per hour, which is fast, but nowhere near as fast as it is right here at the transition zone between sonic and supersonic. Supersonic afterburner reheat turbojet engines. Yeah. We get to use those words in our work on a regular basis. Sometimes I forget how lucky I am. Thanks for watching.